Okay. Hello, Georgia woman. Welcome. What's your name? Hello, welcome. Hi, Rebecca. Don't mean a thing. How are you today? Hi, Courtney. Hello. Hi. We've got Ella Fitzgerald and Duke Ellington bringing us in today. We'll get started in a minute. I just like to let a little music play while we let people get in the door here. Well, I hope that it's any good, Rebecca. I'll tell you guys, I feel nervous. I don't know why. Well, I do know why. I'll talk about it. I was actually going to talk about this last week, and I just could not bring all of my thoughts together. Hey, welcome, mom to five boys. I have five boys too, plus one girl. Thanks, Ella and Duke. I'm gonna turn that off. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I am so glad that you're here today, and I'm excited about what we're gonna talk about today, why homeschoolers should care about Black history. I'm Erica Johns from enrichmentstudies.com. I help homeschool families incorporate more fine arts into their lives in an easy way that doesn't run on a bunch of bomb power, because I have homeschooled for the last 18 years and I don't need anything else to make my life more complicated, but there are always more things I'd like my kids to learn. And arts was one of them, and that's how I kind of got the idea for creating what we do at Enrichment Studies. So, but today, what I want to talk about is why I think Black history matters for homeschoolers. First of all, how many of you do homeschool, and what are maybe the ages of your children? I'd love to hear like kind of who I've got here today. And also, are you doing anything special teaching-wise for Black History Month? I'd like to know about that too, if you want to share. So, I was supposed to do this, I had scheduled for myself to do this last week, and I just could not bring all of my thoughts together, and I just feel very inadequate, I guess, but in 18 years of homeschooling, I haven't seen a whole lot of interest within the homeschool community for Black history in general. And there's probably a lot of reasons that are nothing sinister or whatever. Four kids, 7, 5, 3, and 10 months. Awesome. Awesome. Thank you, Rebecca. I know we all have, the curriculum that we're following, and, usually you have already more than you can handle just with the regular stuff, and that's fine. But I feel really nervous. I'm not an expert at this. I'm probably going to make some mistakes. I hope that you will forgive me and help me do better if you see ways that I can improve. But I'll just start by saying, I've owned Enrichment Studies for 4.5 years, and your kids are killing you. I was there at one time. Hang in there. If you can just keep hanging on one more day, eventually they'll grow up. And my two that are closest are just a little over a year apart, and I used to say that, it'd be really great when they get older that they'd be so close in age, as long as I could survive, if we could all survive till then. And it is really great now that they're older, but there are some tricky days, so bless you. Take your vitamins. In Enrichment Studies for 4.5 years, we have composer study and artist study. We started with the composer study, and I had, when you start out, what are the composers that you can think of? Maybe you guys can share like three composers or three artists right off the top of your head that you can think of that you were going to, if you were going to tell your kids about. Maybe you'd say Mozart or Beethoven or Chopin or Vivaldi. For artists, maybe you'd say Michelangelo or Vincent van Gogh or Claude Monet, right? Chances are, whoever you're thinking of are white European men. And crickets. and it would be very easy for us to believe that white men are the only people that that contributed to the arts throughout history. And that's not actually the case. And this obviously isn't about black history, but for instance, when I started looking, because I thought, you know, what else have we got? You know, I mean, surely there's some women that have done something. Surely there's some non-white men that have done something. What can I find? And what I found was, yes, there are non-white men and women who have been creating the arts, but there's so little information about them. And I'm not sure, you know, I don't have like a whole big long reason or conspiracy theory of why that is, but just that, yes, there have been other non-white men people contributing to the arts throughout history, but yet they're like virtually erased from our awareness, right? I now have a women artists through the ages collection of art appreciation, and I have had several people say to me, I was an art history major in college and I never heard of any of these women. What? We have, you know, accomplished women artists going all the way back at least to the Renaissance that we have work from, and yet they don't even rate in our awareness, you know. And when your kids are learning, you know, our kids are always learning from us, from what we say and from what we don't say. And it would be easy for all of us to believe that white guys made all the great music, made all the great art, right? But it's not so. And so to tie that in, like, that's something I've been wrestling with for a while, because I would love to have more resources that would represent more groups of people. It's so much harder to find enough for me to bring together something, you know, that's like enough to create a resource for you. So that's been a challenge. But as Black History Month was approaching, in case you don't know, it's Black History Month, I was thinking about how in the homeschool world, it seems like we kind of politely ignore Black History Month, you know, except for maybe in recent years. And I could be wrong, and you can all probably now tell me examples of ways that I'm wrong, but it seems like it has not been on my radar that homeschoolers have cared about Black History Month, or that it's been seen as something important. And maybe we feel like we've already, you know, we're already getting all the history that we need. I don't know. And this isn't, you know, I'm not saying anybody's bad. I'm just saying this seems to be the way that it is. You know, the majority of homeschool families, of homeschoolers, are white. Somewhere between probably 65% and 70% as far as the statistics I could find. And it's very likely that most of the other homeschoolers that you hang out with are white. And probably the church or the community groups that you're a part of are probably primarily comprised of white people. And I'm not saying you don't have any people that are non-white, that are your friends or your relatives that you care about, but I'm just saying that's, you know, we tend to be kind of in a white bubble. If you're using any major history curriculum, it was most likely authored by white people who are focused on history that was coming from the perspective of white people. And that's important to realize. And I'm not saying anybody is bad because of this. I don't have anything against any of the authors of my most beloved, you know, history books or anything like that. I'm just saying it's very easy to find yourself in a bubble. And when that happens, you need to be very purposeful to learn about and teach Black history to your children, because there is no white history without black history, without, you know, now talking about American history here, I realize there might be some people that aren't American in this scope, but, you know, Native American history, Japanese American history, we're, all these histories are intersected. And, you know, so it's like, if you think of like, you've got a puzzle and the only pieces that you really have are the white pieces plus a few of the others, that's not the whole picture. And our kids are counting on us to teach them. And, you know, if your kids go away to school someplace, they're probably going to have some sort of black history purposefulness, at least in February. You don't have to have that. So you have to be purposeful to build that in. You know, everybody in the United States learns about slavery and how, you know, Abraham Lincoln freed the slaves. And then we've got like kind of a jump forward and we hear about segregation. But it's all mostly taught from the experience of white people. And, you know, all sorts of people are making up America, making up our history, and it's all very rich and interconnected. And you just need to learn more about those things on purpose in order to have a truer understanding of our history. I have a dear friend, Jacinda Townsend. She is an accomplished writer and novelist. She has a novel that you can get on Amazon called Saint Monkey. She's a black woman and she often writes about race issues. And I was getting some feedback from her about my topic here today and asking her for resources she would recommend. And she said, why should black history matter to everyone? In many ways, since black people were enslaved and then segregated, black history is everyone's American history. For example, it's the history of the way America was founded and structured. Also, black folks are 10 to 15% of the population, depending on how you source it. So it's the history of everyone you know. It's just not usually taught with the history of everyone else you know. It's relegated to a separate month and separate college electives and so forth. I thought that was interesting. Good point. You know, yeah, it's like, this is our history. This does matter. And yet it's like this little, you know, like, oh, did you know, you know, this guy, you know, Eli Whitney made this, or Frederick Douglass did this. Like, you know, we just have like these little pop-ups of famous, accomplished black people throughout history, but not really like a picture of the black experience, okay? And what I think a lot of people don't know is that, you know, like whatever kind of life you had, like for me as a white middle-class woman in America, I've had a certain kind of life experience. It would be easy for me to think that this is what it is, this is what the American experience is for people. But in fact, there's other people who have had a vastly, vastly different experience of being American, of being a woman, whatever. Are you following me? Feel free to make comments or whatever. You need to kind of open your eyes to realizing it's not just the same for every single person. I don't think that Black History needs to be relegated to February, to Black History Month, but I think now is as good a time as any to start. You know, it can be really difficult to find history books that teach from perspectives other than the white perspective. So you need to, you know, purposely seek out resources. I'm actually working on a blog post that'll be up later today at enrichmentstudies.com/blog. That will have some things for you to start with. Now, I'm not an expert. I don't have a huge book list of this. I don't have a ton of recommendations. I have some things that I've put together and that some friends of mine have shared that they have found helpful and valuable. And you know, for as many things as I've learned, I just continue to learn more and more and more things about Black history that are startling and shocking and I had no idea about. And so I feel like not only is this important for us to learn about Black history because we need to teach our children history, we want not just a sanitized white perspective version of history, but also I believe that we need to understand our history, including Black history, because it helps us better understand our present. what contributed to where people are today, what factors have gone on that have contributed to the situations that we have. You know, like, I think this is the part that's been like kind of the sticky wicket for me, because yes, there's obviously the part where I can say to you, you know, like, this is important to teach your kids. But it's also important because it matters for you understanding what's going on today. And when you're listening to the news, when you're hearing current events, when things are going on, when you see, you know, people posting things on Facebook, if you're in the white bubble, you're probably getting a lot of messages that are really not fully understanding what's been going on. So, you know, when we're hearing about issues about race and current events and we're dismissive, we think we already know everything that we need to know, you know, that teaches our kids something. That's saying, you know, if I hear something that's uncomfortable or unfamiliar to me, rejection, you know, we don't have to listen to that. If you can cultivate within yourself a mindset of kind of leaning forward and trying to understand, what does that mean? You know, what are you talking about? You know, who is that person that you're mentioning or that situation that you're referencing? You know, follow the bunny trail and find out, well, what is that thing that they're talking about? Oh, you know, or if people bring up something, you know, racial, current events, whatever, and you don't understand it, you know, why not say, why do you think that? What is that about? Tell me more about your perspective. That is such a powerful and important kind of attitude, I think, to have, that's so lacking in our society today. People want to have knee-jerk reactions to stuff. You know, the internet is full of this, you know, where people just want to rant and rave and be upset and think that they know everything and call people names and whatever. But, you know, you are setting the tone and the expectation, you know, of what's normal for your kids. They're learning from us every day. And very often when things are going on in current events, for instance, Ferguson. When the Ferguson situation was going on, well, I'm a mom who, when I can find streaming video of what's going on, I have my kids gather around. My kids that are homeschooled are 12, 14, 15, and 17. We sat at the computer screen and we watched live streaming of what was going on with people who were, at the time that we saw, peaceful protesters that were being handled quite heavy-handedly by the police. It was really powerful to see what was going on, and it sparked a lot of interesting conversations and the kids talking about, you know, what had gone on and whatever. I can remember having a conversation with someone else in my life who was talking about the Ferguson thing and saying something, and I can't really remember the exact quote, but basically the idea was like, why are they doing that? You know, why is that necessary? Why can't you just, you know, calm down and whatever? And I was thinking, you know, if my sons had been unable to walk to school, a friend's house, church, the park, without being harassed, if my husband, father, brother, friends had been unable to, you know, peacefully go along without being, you know, pulled over simply because they're driving while black, if I was constantly living in fear that any minor infraction or misunderstanding between the police and one of my children could result in them being shot, you can believe that there could be a situation where I could lose it about, you know, a last straw sort of thing. You bet. There would be generations worth of rage and anguish and fear and grief if this had been my experience and my family's experience, the experience of all the people that I hold dear. Now, I'm just a white lady from a small town full of mostly white people, so I might be wrong, and you know, it might not just, I'm sure it's not just that, but I'm just saying I can empathize to say there's a history that goes along with this. And, you know, like when we've got the Black Lives Matter movement going on, you know, I see a lot of attitude that's like, everybody's life matters. You know, what are you talking about? You know, and it's like, you're offended, you know, about this movement. Well, what is it about? I certainly can't speak to all of it, but that's part of what it's about, is that Black people in this country have, since the time they were brought here as slaves, been treated as if their bodies belong to someone else, their opportunities can be limited by someone else. There's been so many crooked and just outrageous things that have gone on. People are fed up, and they should be, and you would be too. And it's only because, you know, I'm living the white lady life that hasn't been the story for my people. But it is the story for our people, you know, our American people. So I really feel like, you know, the Black history thing totally intersects your willingness to look at and push into stuff that's really uncomfortable, that is not sanitized, that can be very painful, that's despicable, that's so hard to understand. There is a crazy, crazy amount of that in Black history, particularly American history, and not long, long ago either. You know, just the other day I was reading, just to give you a little tidbit, I was reading in a news thing, Fifth Third Bank is paying out, I believe it's an $18 million settlement, because they had colluded with car dealerships to charge higher interest rates to Black and Latino people that were trying to get a car loan with buying a car at a car lot. Not because of anything about their creditworthiness, simply because of their race, and they got busted on it. That's happening. That's been going on recently. Okay? You know, so I mean, that's just, you know, one, I could just start blah, blah, blah with all this stuff. You know, I don't know. Feedback, questions, it matters. It just matters so much. 1945, a woman was executed by the electrocution. She fought back and killed her rapist. Oof. Yep. Horrifying. Horrifying. I'm reading a book right now called Between the World and Me by Ta-Nehisi Coates. And I'd hope to have it all read today so I could tell you more about it. But it's a letter. Ta-Nehisi is a Black man. He's writing a letter to his teenage son, and that's what the book is. And he starts out by talking about how he's grown up with the sense that his body is not safely his own, and the Black experience of that. And that's a good example where it's like, somehow, you know, a woman in 1945, a Black woman in 1945, wasn't worthy of self-defense. Whew, there's so much stuff. There is so much stuff. I hope that you'll go and check out the blog. It's at enrichmentstudies.com/blog. It's not up yet. I'm still working on it, and I'm going to stick this video in with it so people can watch it all together. But I have a lot of just articles and places where you can start, and got Facebook groups that I follow that help me become more aware of things. You know, I would say, don't be afraid to have to get into this and not know things yourself. And it doesn't mean that you have to be an expert at it for your kids. You know, you can share these things with your children and just say, you know, I never knew this. Between the World and Me, yes. Yep. It's okay to not know stuff. It's also okay to read about stuff and not change your mind about something. You know, it doesn't mean that everything that you're going to read, you're still going to understand or you're going to agree with or whatever. But you can at least, you know, expand your mind about what are you referring to? You know, when people talk about reparations, you know, what is that about? You know, instead of just having a reaction of no, you know, why are some reasonable people suggesting this? What's that about? Dig in and learn about it. You know, what is the Black Lives Matter thing about? You know, why should it matter to you? Well, you know, because these are our people. These are, you know, our fellow Americans, our fellow earthlings, you know, this matters. And it just all starts with being purposeful and being willing to look into stuff that maybe isn't easy or comfortable. And our kids, you know, deserve to have a better knowledge of these things than we had. And, you know, as homeschoolers, they're relying on us to make it happen. So that's it. Any questions, comments, feedback, or anything before we go? This wasn't as scary as I thought it would be.